Probably you are not going to read the whole chapter this evening. Yeah, let us use the time properly. Testing hypothesis. So this kind of hypothesis, our hypothesis testing, is the second form of statistical inference. As you mentioned, in statistical inference we have two things. We have estimation and we have hypothesis testing. We finish the estimation in chapter 10 and we are starting now hypothesis testing. Hypothesis testing has greater applicability than estimation, but you are going to have a very high degree of similarity between what we studied in estimation and what we are going to study in testing methods. To understand the concept, we will start with an example of non-statistical hypothesis testing. But let us now think, without knowing anything about statistics and estimation and formulas and distribution. In decision making, you are always debating between two decisions. You have two decisions. Okay? You have two decisions. At that end of the way, you have a question and you are going to say yes or no. It can be, مثلاً, you are going to start a new business, yes or no. You have an old business and you would like to expand in it, yes or no. You are going to vote in an election, yes or no, for that candidate. You have a, مثلاً, you want to rent an apartment, you rent this apartment or not, yes or no, etc. Okay? In any of these decisions, including marriage, for example, get married or not get married, so you have always the decision of yes and no, and you have always the possibility of making the wrong decision. Then, for example, if you, the question was open new business, okay, you can go ahead with doing taking that decision and start new business, and the business can be very successful, then this is the right decision. Or, on the contrary, the business will be a failure, and then you discover that you had committed the wrong decision. Okay? On the other hand, if you say, no, I'm not going to open new business, you have the chance to have committed or have taken the right decision by, for example, if you decide not to open the new business, then it is a possibility that you, if you have opened it, it will lose, but you took the right decision here, and if it succeeds, then you have a missed opportunity. But I would say that I have always a sort of 2x2 table. Decision taking, مثلاً yes or no, and this is the decision that you do depending on your feeling, depending on any information, depending on any, and the right decision. Business will be successful or failure. You decide to open, for example, a company to produce any idea? What you like to do in your life? Fans? Fans, okay. She will open a company to produce fans or fans, electric fans. For hair, okay. But That's for him. Acho que é for him, this guy. Anyway, something for him, okay? It's not for men. I don't know. If this business, let us assume that it is a successful business, but you don't know. I mean, you are going to take a risk. You are going to take the decision. You would like to be here. You would like to take that decision to open that business, and the business is successful. And also, on the other hand, you would like to be here. If this business is not successful, for example, there is other people who are producing enough for the market and you will not be able to sell anything extra, then you would love to aim to have taken that decision not to open the new business. Okay? Then you are risking two areas of right decision, and you are having also two areas of wrong decision. Then if you decide to go for that business and the business is a failure, then this is the problem. The other thing, if you decide not to go to that business and the business turns out to be very successful, then you are losing an opportunity. But this is the idea of testing hypothesis. The idea of testing hypothesis, the relevance of that you are taking a decision, regarding the population, based on the sample. Okay? What we are doing in testing hypothesis, I am taking a decision related to the population, then I am saying, for example, that the mu of the population is equal to 100, and it is based on the statistic, and it is based on the sample. So I have always the two situations. I might take a right decision, or I might take a wrong decision. But the right decision, it can take two forms. It can be accepting the null hypothesis, accepting that mu is equal to 100, and in fact it is equal to 100. And in fact it is equal to 100. I don't know the facts, I don't know the truth in statistics, but I am taking a decision based on the sample. Because I cannot go to the whole population and calculate the median. Then, for example, in the case when I'm doing testing hypothesis related to the median of the population, for example, I would say the median, the mean of the population, I'm going to say that in this case, I'm going to say that the mean of the population is equal to 100. And the complement, the mean of the population is not equal to 100. Okay? Then I have two kinds of decisions that each one will produce a certain error. If I take the decision that mu equals 100 based on my sample, but in fact it is not, that this is error. That this is a wrong decision. Or I can say that the mean of the population is not equal to 100, and in fact it is. Okay? Difficult or confusing? Then, yeah, I'm glad to be so good at telling. I mentioned you in a statistical example that you are taking decisions related to opening new business. Let us take the example in statistics. And in testing hypothesis, I am testing hypothesis related to, for example, the population mean. And I am saying that the population mean is equal to 100. Okay? This is my decision, which is this one. The other decision, mu does not equal to 100. Then here I have mu equal 100. And here mu does not equal 100. The population mean. I'm just telling you any example. And based on your sample, you are going to say that I am accepting a new equal 100. I'm rejecting a new equal 100. This is the statistical hypothesis that I'm going to do. So here, you can accept the null hypothesis, you can accept mu equal 100, where in fact it is 100, so this is a good decision. And you can reject that mu equal 100, and in fact it was not 100, that it is a good decision. But always you are risking two other errors, which that based on your sample, you are going to accept the decision, but it turned out to be wrong, or you are going to reject the decision and it turned to be right. Let me give you another non-statistical example. Suppose that you are a judge and you are taking verdict for killing somebody. But you have a suspect and they are saying that he committed a murder, and you are taking a decision either to send him to execute him, or you are going to say no, he is not the right person who commits that crime, and he is not the one who committed that crime. But you have always two decisions to take: either to say that guy is innocent, or that guy is not innocent. But in fact, you don't know the truth, the real truth, you don't know the real truth. They are taking decisions based on what? On the papers that you have. On the papers that you have. But whether the paper will support the tahiyyat, etc., whether it's supporting this decision or that decision. Then you are going to say that he's free, he's innocent, I will send him free. Or no, he's not innocent, I will send him to jail, or I send him to execute him. Okay? That this is the decision that we have. You would love as a judge at the end of your life to be always in the right part. That you would prefer in all the cases to if the defendant is innocent, you would like to say that he is innocent. And if he is guilty, you prefer to send him to execute him. Okay? And you would like to, I will hope, that you are not going to commit any of those mistakes. The first mistake is to say that guy is guilty, whether he is innocent. And the other type of error, you are going to say that guy is innocent, and in matter of fact, he is guilty. Okay? You would like to avoid those two mistakes. And this is exactly what we are doing in testing hypothesis. In testing hypothesis, I have a truth that is unknown to me. What is the mean of the population? Okay? But what kind of decision I'm going to take? I'm going to take my decision depending on the facts that are emerging from the sample. Then I have a sample, I have data, I have calculation, I have statistical analysis. And based on that, I'm going to say I'm going to accept or reject. Accept what? I'm going to always to say that I'm going to accept what we say a null hypothesis. A null hypothesis. Then the null hypothesis, for example, mu equal 100. And the alternative hypothesis, mu does not equal 100. And based on my sample, I'm going to say either I am going to support null hypothesis, or I am going to reject the null hypothesis. Either to accept the null hypothesis or reject the null hypothesis. I am going to do that based on what? On the x-bar. Because we are talking about mu. And if x-bar, I am going to calculate the formula. If the x bar is within a certain range, as you remember, the upper and the lower of the confidence interval, I will have an upper and lower bound. If it falls in this upper and lower bound, I'm going to accept the null hypothesis, otherwise I'm going to reject the null hypothesis. Then I have a rule that I'm going to apply, but you have to remember that always, because you are working with a sample, you don't have the exact truth. You can have the exact truth by going to the whole population, but using the sample, you have always a probability of error. And what we have here in hypothesis testing, that I'm taking a decision, keeping in mind that I have a certain amount of error. A certain amount of error. But I am confident 95% that I am doing the right thing, that I am taking the right decision. This is a story about testing hypothesis. So far, at this point, without going to calculation, you have any question? Any question? Okay. I'm going to go once more over the example for the clinical, for the criminal trial. The criminal trial is an example of testing hypothesis, but we are not using any data, just the concept. In a trial, a jury must decide between two hypotheses. The first hypothesis is that the defendant is innocent. And the alternative hypothesis, the defendant is guilty. Okay? Then they have to make that decision, whether this guy is innocent or he is guilty. Okay? The jury does not know which hypothesis is true. They don't know the truth. But they must make a decision on the basis of evidence that is presented to the trial. If there is, for example, if there is no enough evidence, then probably they will not be able to make the right decision. If they have the right evidence, enough evidence, there will be a clue to the right decision. But at the end of the day, they have a portfolio, a file that has evidence. And based on that evidence, they will take decision. But they don't know for sure the complete truth. The complete truth, maybe it's not known. And this might happen several times in trial. But at the end of the day, they would like to avoid two kinds of mistakes, of potential mistakes. The first mistake is to say that the defendant is innocent, given in fact he is guilty, or to take the other decision by saying that the defendant is guilty, where in fact he is innocent. Okay? Easy? Any question so far? Let us now go to what we are going to do in statistics, in testing hypothesis. If I give you two examples, let us see what we are going to do in terms of steps. The first step is to identify the null hypothesis and the alternative hypothesis based on the question that you have, the problem that you have. For example, I might have an example that is saying that maybe you heard that the Ministry of how the government was thinking of giving 3 loaves of bread to every citizen that is subsidized. And more than that, he has to go to the market and buy bread for himself with a more expensive price that will cost him the excess cost. Like, do you think that 3 loaves of bread is enough per day? They have cutting up money to do. How many loaves of bread? You are eating per day. 6? Ah. Everybody is eating 6? But how many person in this class who is eating on the average per day more than 2 loaf of bread? More than 2? مش في كل طبقة في اليوم كله. طب مين؟ In the whole day. Only 5 or 6 students raise their hand. The others are getting less than 2 loaves per bread per day. You are biased on it. Now, if you would like to, as you know, everybody is criticizing the government, but nobody is using real data in qualifying that argument. But the right thing is to go, instead of saying no, the government is wrong, the government is wrong, is to go and to have a sample of people and to ask everybody how many loaves of bread are you eating per day. And then you take those figures from the sample and you can calculate your X bar. And let us assume that the X bar was 3.2, for example. And the sample size that I used for that was 1,000 persons. And the standard deviation was 0.2. And I would like to say, does this real data, instead of saying the government is right or wrong from the political point of view and just to support the government, we are against the government without any argument. I'm going to go to the field and collect data, and from this data I would like to say I think the government is correct by saying 3 loaves, or the government is not correct by saying 3 loaves per day. Okay? This is a question that I'm going to answer using statistical hypothesis. And this is the application of systems, these sorts of problems. Okay, you agree? Okay. Let us take another example. Since we don't have transparency in Egypt, you don't have transparency or transparency? Yeah, a little bit transparency. There is a lot of data that we don't know exactly what's going on, but we have some impressions, for example. That, those professors in university are getting are very highly paid. Yeah. Okay. What do you think? How much are they getting? I think they are getting at least £20,000 per month. That they are overpaid. Probably they are getting £20,000 per month. Yeah, this is unfair. I have some other old of it. It's not worth it. But I would like to know how to evaluate those university professors. Okay, you are going to, since you don't have transparency, there is no declaration of your income of the people who are working for the university or the government, which is happening in other countries, by the way. In Brazil, if you go to Brazil and you go to the internet, you can find all employees in the government, their salary listed on the internet, starting from the president to a IELTS. Okay? And as you know, Brazil is, the size of Brazil in terms of population is like 2.5 times the size of Egypt, but probably the government has also a larger, they have a larger government, and you have 6 million in the government, they have maybe 10 million whatever. This can be done. But anyway, since you don't have transparency, I'm going to go to interview a sample size of the professor in Cairo University, or like all universities, and to ask them about their salary. Assume they are honest and they will tell you the truth, but I will end up with an X bar for the average salary of professors based on a sample. your hypothesis that those guys are getting 20,000 pounds on average. But I would like to know whether your sample data is supporting that hypothesis or not. Whether based on your sample, you are going to accept the null hypothesis or reject the null hypothesis. The third example, let us assume that the Egyptians have high cholesterol level. Cholesterol level, because they are eating junk food, a lot of Kentucky, which are pizza or McDonald's, etc. And this is increasing the cholesterol level. But I believe that those guys, especially the young people in Egypt, they have a higher cholesterol. Let us assume that we have a previous study, as 20 years ago, where potentially McDonald's and we don't have at that time we don't have McDonald's and Kentucky, etc. Again, it was not yet that common. Let us assume that the cholesterol level, the average cholesterol level of youth, Egyptian youth, was 150. And 150 is okay, it's not very high, it's an average cholesterol level. And I would like to know whether the young Egyptians in 2013, they have a higher cholesterol level compared to the previous generation. But I'm testing the hypothesis that the average cholesterol of young Egyptian people is 150, no change. Or it is changing due to myself, eating habits, for example. I'm going to take a sample from those young Egyptians, and I'm going to, of course, I cannot take the whole population, I'm going to take just a sample, then to calculate how I need to measure the cholesterol, I need to take a blood sample from you, and then to take it to the lab, and then to find out what is your cholesterol level, okay? And based on that sample, I'm going to find, for example, that the cholesterol level was 160. Okay? And I would like to know whether 150, 160 is consistent with the hypothesis that the cholesterol level is not different from 150 or not. You have to remember that we are not comparing X bar and mu mathematically. Mentioned here is the number of local breads, it was 3. The 3 is not equal to 3.2. I know that mathematically, but statistically it is a different story. Why? Because this is constant and this is random value. But my sample was 3.2, but maybe if another person used the same population and have another sample, it might be 3.1. It might be 2.9. It might be 3. But I would like to know whether this sample, which is a random variable, based on a sample of 1,000, supports the fact that the Egyptian people are eating on the average 3 loaves of bread per day, or the cholesterol level of young people is not different from 150, as it used to be 20 years ago, or etc. etc. But the idea that I am comparing here a value that is constant with a value that is a random variable. The x bar is a random variable. But I cannot calculate it mathematically by saying that, well, 3 is not equal to 3.2, and I don't need to do anything. They are not equal. They can be equal because this is a random variable that has a certain variability. And I would like to know what is the chance that this x bar is coming from a population with mu equal to 3. Because I know that each sample will be give me different results from one sample to the other, that is slightly different results, then I have a more complicated problem to take the decision here, not only to compare the two figures if they are exactly equal or not, no, I have to go beyond that, because I might have a slight difference between the two figures, but that does not mean that mu, I reject mu. And if I have difference of Point two, this does not mean that I have to reject you. I will accept you, but this will be based on the calculation that I'm going to do in testing items. The last point in this lecture, that will take only 40 minutes, is to show you my decision table. Okay? Then I have each node, which is the another hypothesis, and I have H1, which is the alternative hypothesis. As I mentioned, for example, as example, H node can be a node mu equal 3. You are the number of loaves on the average the Egyptian will eat per day is 3 loaves per day. Okay? Then this is mu. I want to say H node mu equal 3 and H1 mu does not equal to 3. Okay? And you don't know the mu, I know that. But in many cases, you have a hypothetical value that you would like to support or reject. But when the government say the Egyptian people on the average they are eating 3 loaves per day, whatever results in it, it's hypothetical result. Maybe it is coming from Aulek. Digaya, when you think the amount of consumption of bread in Egypt and you divide it by the number of people, it will come up to 3 per day. Okay? But in a matter of fact, in Egypt not only human beings are eating bread, as you know. People who are raising poultry, you know, bread. Yeah, we have subsidized bread, why not also to share with those poor chicken, why not have it? Then they can eat. But there is also a lot of waste in the use of bread. But let us assume that the decision that the government is going to take is based on new pursuit. So this is hypothetical, in that example. Okay? But I would like to know, if I do scientific research on this population, does this is true or not? Okay? But the government or anybody will go and say, I'm not sure that this is correct, I'm going to validate that result. I'm going to check that result. Let me take a sample, okay? And based on the sample, I'm going either to accept H node or to reject H node. Be careful that here I am not telling you that mu equals 3. I am telling you either mu equals 3 or does not equal 3, but I am very little. But this part is the one that is supporting the decision that the government is thinking of. Okay? But if you accept the null hypothesis and H node is equal to mu equal 3, this is good or bad? This is good. If you accept the null hypothesis and in a matter of fact mu does not equal to 3, this is an error. Okay? I will call it type 1 error. Okay? And usually we call it alpha. Short to alpha regression. This is the same alpha that we have seen. There is a correspondence. But this will be if accept is not about given it is true. Given it is wrong. And I can reject H node and H node is wrong. Okay? Accept H node and H1 is true, either this is also correct decision. But what about this? I'm going to reject H0 and H0 is correct. I will call it type A 2, because why have only one implementation? Type 2 error. And I call it here
alpha, beta,
beta. Beta. Well, I call it alpha or beta. The beta alpha team. If this is a bad, it says to me, can I have one of the best or beta? This is alpha, this is beta. But this is actually what I will end up with. I am now deciding to take one of those decisions. I don't know the truth, but I am putting that model to sort of model what to sort of understand what kind of errors I might commit when I take one of those errors. The remaining question in this chapter is how to accept or reject. How am I going to accept or reject the null hypothesis? Okay? I'm going to accept the null hypothesis or reject the null hypothesis based on what my sample, because I cannot go to the whole population. And I'm going to make some calculations in the sample and find out a decision rule. A decision rule. That will tell you if you have a certain result within a certain range, accept. If it is out of the range, reject. Okay? Then we are going to go through that later. But the main idea that I would like to leave it with you is that I have a hypothesis, null hypothesis, alternative hypothesis. And then I have the sample. Based on the sample, I'm going to accept or reject. The acceptance or rejection will be based on a decision rule, and the decision rule will be connected to the confidence interval that we studied in estimation. You remember the confidence interval? We have the lower limit, the upper limit. It's two of us. Last one is there. Study that last Wednesday, chapter 10. We end up with the confidence interval for what? For a?
Mu.
For mu? Well, so I'm not being very much after 70 we did it again. We have Alzheimer already? We have. Okay. Good. But I'm going to take the decision based on the confidence interval that I calculated in the last chapter, and I'm going to say if I have this confidence interval, if I have this upper limit and lower limit, then I'm going to take the decision based on mu, that if the value of mu that is here falls within the confidence interval that I calculated, I'm going to accept the null hypothesis. If it falls outside that confidence interval, I'm going to reject my hypothesis. Then, the decision rule, I want you to take notes because this chapter is a little bit longer in the book, then I would like to get the idea. Now and then after that, you can read it as you wish. Then the decision rule, I'm going to calculate upper limit and lower limit, and it is based on the confidence interval. And this is exactly what we did in chapter 10. And then what I'm going to say, if mu falls this interval, if mu is greater than the lower and less than the upper limits, I'm going to say it, I'm going to A. Accept H mode, and if not, otherwise, I'm going to reject H mode. Okay? Then I will have the calculation from the sample to calculate the confidence interval. The confidence interval has upper limit and lower limit. If the value of mu that I am testing falls within this confidence interval, I am going to accept the null hypothesis. If it falls outside it, I am going to reject the null hypothesis. That's all the story. That's all the story for the first half of chapter 11. Any question? No questions? Yeah, in the calculation, this is exactly the same way to calculate the confidence interval. The same formula. Factor layer x bar plus kappa over x bar minus kappa. So I am taking the results from the sample and calculating the lower limit and the upper limit. And then the decision rule is nothing but to see this value, to see if it fits or does not fit. If it fits, I'm going to say I'm going to accept the analysis. If it does not, I'm going to say I'm going to reject the analysis. This is the whole story. Let us say, what is the alpha and what is the beta and how we are going to get it. The alpha is usually the 5% that we have seen before, for error. And this is the alpha. The beta, you don't have to worry about it, you are not going to be asked to calculate it out using it. At least for the first two or three courses in synthesis. But at least you would like to know that alpha is the probability of A accepting the null hypothesis given, rejecting the null hypothesis given is true, and beta is the probability of accepting the null hypothesis given is correct. But these are the two definitions that I would like you to know, and I would like you to know that we have a formula or a decision rule that we are going to use, and we are going to apply it, and then we are going to, based on that, we are going to decide whether we accept or reject the null hypothesis. When I accept or reject the null hypothesis, I know that I am subject to an error of alpha, which is, for example, 5%. Then I am saying that I am 95% confident that, for example, the government is correct in saying that it will give 3 loaves on the average to everybody. And this is a correct decision. But I am not 100% sure, and 95% sure, because I have an error of alpha, that in this example I decided, or it was given to me, that it is 5%. Okay? Of course we are going to have a lot of practical examples, but please read the concept. I want you to come in the next lecture where the concept still knows A. And for everybody, have a nice vacation, and for some time here, especially A and Talawa, for some time here, my essay. And to see you, inshallah, in Asfas recess. But don't forget that you have on Wednesday 2 math lectures instead of the STEM lecture. Okay? We are now talking about confidence interval, and what we are talking about is to give an estimate of the parameter of the population that is unknown using a formula that is based on the sample statistics. And in the case that you are presenting, we are talking about how to estimate mu using a confidence interval. And to estimate mu, that is an amount that is unknown, we are going to use the sample mean, and using that formula to end up with a lower bound and an upper bound. What it is important to retain in terms of the last point that you mentioned in today's lecture is related to the interval we agree on the following, that the internal width has to be narrow to be useful for the decision-making process. And to make it narrow, we have to look at those three terms, the end, the sigma, and the confidence level. The confidence level is, for example, the statement that, the probabilistic statement that I'm making, I'm saying that I'm confident 95% that the population mean range from 300 to 400. And the confidence interval, if you are going to increase the confidence level, keeping everything in place without any changes, and for the same n, for the same sigma, from the same population, if you would like to increase the confidence level from 90 to 95, using the same data, you will end up with a wider confidence interval. But here we have the first problem. Do we need a wider confidence interval? Well, we don't need a wide confidence interval. Then we have to balance between the two. How to balance between the two? By increasing n. For example, if I take the example of the health problem, I would like to know the percent of people who have the disease. And if you fix 95% confidence interval, you end up with a certain confidence interval. 95%. Like if you are willing to compromise a little bit in your confidence and say 95% is too much, I will be happy with 90%, then you can end up with a wider, shorter, narrower confidence interval. Okay? The more that you would like to be confident, the wider the confidence interval will be for the same results. But I do not want to make it too wide, because too wide means that it's not going to be useful in terms of the decision making. Then if I found that it is too wide and you would like to make it narrower, you can increase the sample size. Okay? This is the story. So to say, I want to make wrapping up for that part. If the width of the confidence interval, if it is narrower, it is better for the decision maker. But to be more confident, the more confident you would like to be, you have to have a wider confidence interval. But if it is too wide for the decision maker, then you have to increase the sample size. If you find it too wide for the impact can usually we are using 95% confidence interval. And sometimes we are using 90% confidence interval or 99% depending on the application, but usually we are using 95% confidence interval. Then if you end up with a 95% confidence interval and the decision maker finds it wider than he expects, then he has to pay the price to make it narrower. Make it narrower by increasing the sample size. Okay? Easy or difficult? Any question? Are you confused? You are not confused? You want to be confused? Or, it's okay. Okay, Karan? This is the same drawing that I made here. If you have 90% confidence interval, it is wider than the 95% confidence. And as I mentioned, we have the confidence level, and we have also the population standard deviation. And here it is showing three different levels of the sigma. The green one is the larger standard deviation, so the population is spread over a wider range. And the black one is sigma equal 1, and that one is sigma equal half. Then if you have a wider population, the original population wider, there is more spread, there is larger sigma, then you are having a wider confidence interval. How to solve that problem? To increase the sample size. This means that if you have two populations, one that has a large sigma and one has a small sigma, then in the large sigma you need to pay more price. You need to pay higher price. Higher price is the business, needs to have a larger sample size. Then to compensate for working with a population that has a large sigma, you need to have to increase sample size. Of course, the N, as you mentioned, increasing the sample size will decrease the width of the confidence interval, while the confidence interval can remain unchanged. While the confidence level, and for the same confidence level, if you want to make it narrower, increase the sample size. Note, this also increases the cost of obtaining additional data. Increasing sample size, sometimes it is expensive. If you are doing, for a survey or a public opinion polling, and you are working with 2,000, and somebody tells you, this confidence interval is too wide, you have to vary it, and you have to, instead of using 2,000, you have to use less than 3,000, which means more cost, higher cost. We have an important term, which is the error of estimation. Now, the sampling error. The sampling error is in itself the range that we are talking about. It is not an error from the mathematical point of view. It is a sampling error. And if you are using sample, if you are using your sample versus using the whole population, what is the range that you are working on? But this is what we call the sampling error, or the error of estimation. And it is expressed as the difference between the X bar and the mu. As we mentioned, the term that we are using and subtracting is Z. Lambda Z alpha over 2 times sigma divided by square root of n, and this is what we call the error of estimation, the amount that you are adding or subtracting from x bar to find a range for you. We are estimating only. But this is the difference that you are adding or subtracting. But this term is the error of the estimation. I'm going to call it B. B is easier for us. I'm going to call this error B. If you make B equal Z times sigma over square root of n, then you can make some calculation and find out n, and n, this is the sample size that you need to use to have a certain amount of error. Because usually you are asking, what is the right sample size? How big the sample is, etc. This is a simple calculation for the sample size, but of course, if you specialize in statistics, where you are going to find more details that are linked to that topic, but this is just to satisfy your eagerness to know, because many people ask me about what is the sample size, what is the value of the sample size. This is how we are getting the value of the minimum sample size. Any question? If the term B, this is the term that you are adding or subtracting from x bar to find out the lower limit and the upper limit, and we are calling this the error of estimation, and you can use this error term to evaluate the sample size that you have. If you go back, for example, to the example of the health problem, and would like to know the an estimation of the people who have a certain disease, and I will calculate the confidence interval, and I'm going to say, for example, the proportion range from 10% to 18%. But the range is from 10% to 18%. Eight. Now what would be the error of estimation? Check now, we're adding something and subtracting something. Now you again.
Consultant.
So, robots, it's error, so everyone's fine together. Right. You see, the range, the level of confidence, is from 10 to 18. And 10 to 18 is a x bar minus Hagen, x bar plus Hagen. Where the amount that you are subtracting from x bar and adding to x bar is the error of estimation. What would be the error of estimation if I'm talking about confidence intervals from 10 to 18? So 8 is the 4. 4. 4. Make sense? 14 minus 4 and 14 plus 4. You are from 10 to 18. The difference? And you will have to reduce it to 3 months. you have to increase the sample size. You agree? You agree?
Agree.
You agree that if you would like to reduce the estimation, the error of the estimation, you have to increase the sample size. Now increase it by how much? I can plug it here. Okay, if B is 4, this will be the N. If B is 3, this will be the N. So I can make and calculate the sample size that is required. Why I'm using this formula? Because sometimes you are asking me that how much is a good sample size? How much do I hope to go? 1,000, 1 million, 10, 15, etc. There is a formula that relates the sample size to the lower hierarchical bound of the difference of the error of the estimation. Now if you think, for example, another application, if you are, there is a company that is producing new medication. For new medication, the bound should be very small. And you need a confidence level, high confidence level. But you might decide to say that I need a larger sample size. But how large is the sample size? How far I want to go for a bound of, not 4%, but 1%. But in the meantime, I want to be confident. Which 90%, 95%, or which 95%, 99%. But you can use this formula. I took examples, but I'm just presenting the idea. To illustrate, suppose that before gathering the data, the manager has decided that he needs to estimate the mean demand during heat time, the example that we talk about today, with 16 units. But instead of using, at the beginning, he thought that the sample size of 16 is enough. Okay? Sample size of 16 is enough. But where we have this 95%, and the sigma, as you remember, is 75. But he calculated the sample size and he found that the sample size is 84. The sample size is 84.
Well,
you have to sample size because this is a point that I don't have to pass. Because the calculation is better, you get rounded. Right? If it is less than 5, you can take it out. If it is 5 or more, you can make it 55. Okay? But for a given calculation, you need 84. You remember, and then we started our example by saying that he has a sample size of 25. And he ended up with a range that was ranging from 344 to 399. That is the confidence interval. But an error you can handle, error of estimation, can measure again in 44, the error can measure in 56. Yeah, the error at 28. Now guy, he thinks that 28 is too much. He wants to have the error at 16. Or 20. 16 units. If you want to have the error at 16, you need a sample size of how much? 84. Okay, I have the sample size again. 25. Yeah, but if you need to be more precise, if you need a narrower sample, narrower confidence interval, what you have to do is to go from 25 to 84. This is the idea of the sample size. في حاجة مش فاهمها؟
أنا؟ لا فاهم الحمد لله.
ولا في حاجة فاهمها؟
الحمد لله.
مش
فاهم إيه؟ مش عارف. لا مفيش.
طيب خليني اقول الستوري كده بطريقه اجماليه. احنا usually we start by saying that I'm going to use a sample size of 25. مثلا. مش 35 marks. And let us assume that we start with 7.25 in this exam. And we end up with the confidence interval. As a decision maker, you prefer to see a sample size that is a wider, that is a narrower. If you think that the sample size was wide, too much for you, but I'm going to say that this sample size that we calculated in the previous example, the error of estimation was 30. Like 30 is too much. I wanted only 60. The decision maker was not happy with the confidence interval. He thinks that's too wide. Like, what should he do? He should increase the sample size. But increase it, we care, we care. It depends on how accurate you would like to be, how precise you would like to be. If instead of using a wider confidence interval, you need a narrower one. Now, how narrow you would like to be? I want to have the question, you need to have the error of estimation 16 points. Then it will be x bar plus 16 and minus 16. To have it 16, then b has to be 16. And the other two values are the same, no change. The same confidence level and the same sigma. To have a confidence interval with an error of estimation of 16, you need a sample size of 84. Instead of sample size can care 25. Previously it was 25. Okay, but this is the story. You calculate the confidence interval. You show it to the decision maker. He said, you know, this is too wide. But how narrow you would like to go? I want to go to only 16 points, plus or minus 16. But if you want to go to 16, if this is the sample size I should use, but you have to increase your sample size instead of using the sample size of 25, you have to go to the sample size of 84. Let's say, any questions?